There's a good chance that you know the Burt's Bees line of skincare products, but did you know that Burt was a real person and that he really had bees? In the incredible documentary Burt's Buzz, now streaming for free on EntrepreneurTV, viewers meet Burt Chavitz, a reclusive, bee-loving man who built a billion-dollar company without intending to. We have the director and producer of the film, who's also an entrepreneur himself, owning and operating the restaurant Antler in the Toronto, Canada area. We are so excited today to do a live Q&A with Jody Shapiro. Jody, here we go.
Howdy.
Great to have you here. And so, I mean, I know it's been a long journey with this film. It came out a little bit ago, and even then, how many years did this film take to produce?
It took a good couple of years between shooting and editing and getting it out. So yeah, it's a long journey, and one that I'm still happy gets to kind of live on in new places. So this is great.
Burt Chavitz is such an incredible character, and it's such an enduring legacy for sure. And I think there's a lot of things I want to talk about. Of course, the film, some stories about Burt, and take any questions from the chat for sure. But I also want to make sure that we talk about the fact that you yourself are an entrepreneur, not even as a filmmaker, which you are, but the owner and operator of this incredible, regional restaurant in Toronto. So we will get to that and more. But before we get into the questions, folks, we are going to watch a little trailer so that you get a sense of this fantastic documentary called Burt's Buzz. So here we go.
I got granola between my teeth. Should I get up and wash my mouth out?
I had no desire to be a upward mobile rising yuppie with a trophy wife, a trophy house, a trophy car. I'm less interested in the inside of whatever it is I own than on the outside of what it sits on. It wasn't as if I'd summoned these bees down or gone looking for them. It was an act of God. I mean, it was a no-brainer.
The growth of the company is astonishing.
There was no company. My bees were the company. My truck was the company. My chainsaw was the company.
People always wanted to know, is there really a Burt? Does he really look like that?
Burt was never trying to build a billion-dollar company, ever.
I don't know whether he wanted to exit the company or he was pushed.
No one's ever owned me. No one's ever gonna own me. You can rent somebody, but you can't buy them. Most people, all they know is the image. You know, that there's Burt and Burt's Bees,
He's like Colonel Sanders, and he simply does not understand that.
As a celebrity of sorts, I'm contractually obligated not to say buzz off.
Free sample Burt's Bees lip balm.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
This is what puts people 6 feet under. I don't need it. A good day is when no one shows up and you don't have to go anywhere.
Incredible. I love it. I've seen the film several times now. He's just such an incredible character. And I mean, first things first, I mean, how did you get involved with making this documentary?
Yeah, well, Burt, it's kind of a long story. I'll try to simplify it. I work as a filmmaker with an actress, and she's a director as well now, named Isabella Rossellini. We've worked together for a number of years. Isabella did a series of films that I helped her out with called Green Porno. It's a whole other story for a whole other day, I think. But there were these little short films about the sex lives of insects where she plays the insects. They're done in a very cartoony way. Somebody from the Burt's Bees company had contacted us to do some of these kind of little short cartoony type films, but about Burt and Burt's Bees, kind of a, I guess a small little kind of advertising thing that they were looking at doing. And Isabella said, sure, I'd be interested in doing that. I never realized Burt was a real person, as none of us did, but I want to go meet him first. So we went to go meet him. We went to his little cabin out in Maine and met with him, and he just turned into the most fascinating person that we had ever met. As you could see, sort of basically some of his personality traits that kind of come out in the film. He's of this kind of quirky eccentric. So while I was there, we had decided after speaking with the company that Burt is getting older. He's got such a fascinating history with the company that it would be great to just film just 2 or 3 days of interviews with him to archive, just as an archive, to kind of just get some footage of him, just to sort of bank, so it just, his wisdom and his stories wouldn't disappear. And I had kind of offered to do that because, again, I thought he was sort of this fascinating person. And spent a good couple of days there just interviewing him, getting him to talk about these stories. And then, of course, the wheel started turning, going, I think there's a bigger story here. But I kind of put it aside because I wasn't interested in just telling the story of a biography of somebody. Type of films that I like to do is that there's sort of a either a journey or a deeper level that you kind of want to explore. Although Burt kind of had this fascinating side of the company, I just kind of felt like there was something else that was needed there. And that's when I found out that Burt was considered a rock star in Taiwan. He was an icon there. People showed up at the airport and
specifically in Taiwan.
He was like, he's just this crazy icon that they just kind of fell in love with there. I don't know. And when I found out that he was actually going to do a tour in Taiwan, a promotional tour, I thought, okay, well, there's the film. Because there's a really interesting dynamic that can be explored now. Who is Burt the man, this guy that just wants to kind of live in the woods all alone, that doesn't care about money or friends or technology or anything like that, versus Burt the icon, this person that is seen on the pack of the lip balm that you've used for the last 15, 20 years, and that gets treated like, you know, the Beatles arriving when he arrives in at the airport in Taiwan.
Feel like that in the film. Yeah. You're like, wow. And he's so overwhelmed almost, right? A little bit. Like he doesn't know what to do with it.
Well, that's it. So once I realized all this was happening, I thought, you know, after meeting Burt, after kind of spending a few days with him, after understanding that this was a person that had a very interesting and deep-rooted philosophy in nature and life, and really lived the way that he wanted to live, had this whole other side of him that we had to explore, and I wanted to explore the dynamic of what those two sides meant, and that's kind of what led me to the film.
I mean, it's the intention behind it is very clear because that's exactly what the film is. And I think there's something that's very appealing about Burt's lifestyle to a lot of people, like that living off the grid type of thing. Was there any, you know, moment where, you know, you learn more about it, you were watching him getting to know his philosophy. Did you ever think, I could do this? Have I ever thought about going off the grid? Is that something that ever crossed your mind?
Well, I can't wait to get off the grid. I'm counting down the days. I'm a city boy. I was born and raised in the city, but over the years, and certainly, like as you alluded to, this idea of this restaurant that I have, and foraging, and wild foods and stuff like that, has gone a great appreciation of nature. Certainly, from being with Burt and seeing everything that he accomplished and the way that he lived his life. Deepened my appreciation of nature. And now, you know, it's March 10th in Toronto, and all I can think about is getting up to the maple trees that we have on a property and getting maple syrup going. So, you know, that's kind of certainly there's been an impact there. There's no question.
That's a bit, yeah. Oh yeah, how much Burt would have loved that. That's incredible. Oh, yeah. And I mean, you talk a little bit about your business, right? You started this business, Antler, this restaurant, after making the film. Was there an influence from the filmmaking process that led you to that, or how did that happen?
Well, from the filmmaking process, again, we talked about it was a good 2-year process. It took a year to shoot because one reason through the film is I wanted to try and spend as much time with Burt as I could. So we shot over the course of a year. I wanted to kind of, because nature was such an important part, I wanted to be with him through all the seasons. And then it took forever to edit. During that time that I was editing and being so involved in this project, I really had to do something to get my head out of it, just to kind of just reset myself. And I ended up enrolling in cooking school, basically. I did a nighttime continuing education courses at a local culinary college, and I absolutely fell in love with it. Just the process, the immediacy of it, the nature of working with ingredients, and all these things that I liked about putting together from a storytelling perspective, I loved doing it with food. At the same time, a good friend of mine, who's now my business partner, who's actually a real trained chef, did a lot of work with wild foods and foraging and nature. And I started going foraging with them, and I started taking pictures, and we started documenting things for a cookbook that we wanted to do. And one thing led to another, and I got very, very excited about the storytelling aspects of understanding where your food comes from, not just farm to table, but sort of this forest to table, this wild things. I started going into the woods and foraging and finding things wild leeks and wild mint and fiddleheads. And suddenly your eyes open up and you see this whole world outside in front of you that you've never really experienced before, because you never knew how to recognize recognize these things. And once you start doing this, whole world opens up. And I thought, from a filmmaker perspective, this is really interesting to explore. The way this relates to Burt's was the fact that I never wanted to give up filmmaking. I certainly wanted to explore a passion in food, and we started doing pop-up dinners, and they were becoming quite successful using wild ingredients that we would forage and get. I loved the storytelling aspect of it. What Burt's taught me about the way it was released and distributed, we had a great distributor called Film Buff that basically this was sort of the real emergence of streaming. It was the first time that I had a film that was able to go onto iTunes. This is, 10 years ago. Netflix was really just kind of getting very, very popular on the streaming side of things. It wasn't so much of this need to get something on TV or to get something onto a big screen. I was very happy to go a digital route with this film. And then I realized that as an independent filmmaker, if you get the right article, if you get the right PR, if you get the right kind of way of getting the word out there, all you need is a link to get somebody to watch your content. And I still remember, again, this is 10 years ago, Instagram wasn't really around, Twitter was sort of the big thing. And I remember two things happened. One of them was Time magazine wanted to run an exclusive clip of the film. So I was able to just at home on my computer create a little a clip on my own from my office, upload it to Time magazine. They tweeted it out to their 2 million people, and like the next day we were number one on iTunes US. And that also BuzzFeed did something, 10 things you don't know about Burt or whatever. And the next day, like, my website crashed, and that
the literal just, BuzzFeed.
Yeah, exactly.
It's Buzz.
and that really taught me this, and I thought, if I want to work on stuff that's more immediate, if I want to tell stories, I can tell stories about anything I want. I can do it myself if I have the power to be able to release it and distribute it. And that's where the restaurant came in. I thought, if I get a brick and mortar place, a place that I'm kind of, fascinated about the potential from a storytelling perspective about where your food comes from and how to cook. And I mean, there's a lot of sort of ideas that could surround food and restaurants. I can create content, I can release content on YouTube, I can market it, I can get stuff out there, and I wouldn't have to wait and do things through the regular kind of system. You know, that was maybe my more kind of entrepreneurial sort of way of thinking about it, I guess. And that's been, it's been a wonderful influence on that side, you know, to understand the power that we have to be able to release our own content. And this was pretty much before viral videos and TikTok and all that kind of stuff. So I was thinking more long form at the time. So that's kind of how one thing led to the other without having to give anything up.
And how has it been in your journey, like to a certain degree, pivoting towards this restaurant? Yeah. Like, how long has the restaurant been around?
7 years now. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah,
amazing.
You know, because the film's about a decade old. But it's, the one problem with everything I just said was that running a restaurant got in the way. So we were very popular right at the very beginning. I wanted to cook a lot, you know, in the early days and sort of put the camera down a little bit and just kind of get into that groove. But we became a successful restaurant. And so the idea of being able to kind of create a little studio at the same time kind of took a bit of a backseat. Now, finally, getting back into it for sure, definitely.
I love it.
Lots of new ideas, lots of food-related ideas.
Well, I mean, what content does better than food to a certain degree? It's
exactly.
Like renovation and food.
Yeah.
So looking forward to the Antler reality show.
Thank you.
maybe we'll make it together. I would love, you know, watching the film, and you spent so much time with him. Could you tell us a little bit about maybe like a favorite scene or a favorite memory of Burt? Because he's just such a lovable curmudgeon.
I mean, there's many, almost all the things, you know, that we have in the film were certain things that I kind of really cherished about him. I think one of the things that really kind of spoke to me about the person who he was when I saw him light a fire in his stove. And in fact, we actually, I was so taken by it that I decided I wanted to end the film with him doing this methodical ritual that he did. And to me, that's kind of said everything about him, just the way he fanned it, the way he cut the wood, the way he piled it up, the way he just had this kind of way about him, this routine about him that just spoke volumes about the kind of person that he was and how he related to sort of nature around him. But the other interesting thing about him that I didn't see at first, and it was only when we started making the film, was that he was also a man of contrast. There was, everybody always wanted to try and define him in some way. And I just felt like he was a person that was impossible to define. He loved being alone and in nature, but he also loved staying at a 5-star hotel. He didn't want fans or anybody coming up, you know. He had posted signs on his property, you better, you know, be good or be gone, I think was his saying. But yet he'd be more than happy to spend 2 hours signing autographs to people when he was in Taiwan. And I just loved this kind of idea that you can have these values, but also not have to be defined into one kind of, you know, pigeonhole. Burt, he was an entrepreneur as well. I mean, he started, he was making something like 16 bucks a week selling honey by the side of the road. He picked up a hitchhiker one day, Roxanne Quimby, who became his partner in the company. She said, "What are you doing with the wax from the honey that you're making?" He said, "I'm just got it stored." She's like, "Let me make wax candles and we'll sell it at craft fairs." So she took that, and that's where they started. And they went from basically, you know, 16 bucks a week to 15 years later, selling it for close to $1 billion. You know, there's not many stories like that, you know. And
it really, it is kind of the dream. And it's just funny for so many people, I'm sure, watching and hearing about it. It's like, that's what I want to happen, but it happened to them by accident. And it's so, I mean, not by accident, but a little bit less intentional to like blow it up into a $1 billion company. And so it is funny to where you find inspiration or collaboration, really. It is a testament to collaboration. And And I think that collaboration, for those of you who haven't seen the film, doesn't go quite as Burt would have liked, but I think that it is a testament to that for sure. And it definitely a film that surprises you, and a beautiful portrait. I think that you know, everybody out there who's interested, go to entrepreneur.com/TV and you can watch it on any of our platforms. Jody, before we wrap up here, is there anything you want to tell the audience about the film or about Burt or even about what you've been up to to kind of wrap it up and give yourself a little plug?
Oh, thanks. Well, I appreciate you mentioning Antler. If anyone's in Toronto, come on, drop by. I love the fact that you guys are continuing to breathe some life into this film. I think it's, Burt was a unique character, and unfortunately he passed away a few years back. So we all do really miss him, but I think he was kind of one of a kind. He was somebody that is this rare person that you find nowadays who is, I think, very true to himself. He really, really just had what he wanted and lived the way that he wanted to live. And he didn't, if you watch the film, there are certain adventures and things that happened to him that maybe didn't necessarily turn out in his favor. And maybe there was some bitterness about it, but he didn't let it stop and control his life. As he likes to say, he got up when the sun rises and he goes to bed when the sun sets. And that was sort of the simplicity of the way kind of he really liked to live his life. That was the man. The icon was somebody a little different, but that's sort of the interesting way to be able to explore, who he was.
He's a great reminder of, almost having boundaries around like who you are and what you want in a way that is so almost a fantasy for, I think, a lot of folks. And so that's what I love about it. But Jody, so glad to have you on here talking about the film. Love the film and so glad that it's part of our ecosystem at Entrepreneur TV. And so appreciate your time and everybody out there watching. Thanks so much. Check out the film and much, much more on Entrepreneur TV. We are streaming for free on multiple platforms, and it's only getting bigger and better from here. So thanks so much, folks. And thank you, Jody.
Awesome. Thank you. Thanks very much.